Good afternoon, welcome to the Book of Voice. And we're here today with Andy Thomson, who's running for seat B with the Boca Raton City Council. Welcome, and thank you for joining us.
Once again, Peter, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure.
Thanks. Now, Andy, today we've got to ask you a few questions just about what's going on in Boca Raton, and we want to find out how's it going on the trail for your candidacy for the Boca Raton CP.
It's been going really good, Peter. We have been hitting the doors, hitting the phones. Last few months, we've been knocking on doors, and over time, my group of volunteers has grown dramatically. I have a great group of about 10 to 15 volunteers that get with me every weekend. These are FAU kids for the most part, and they spend most of their weekend helping me make phone calls, helping me knock on doors. Last weekend, just alone, we called about 500 people and knocked on about 750 doors, all in one weekend. So we are making big strides out there in the neighborhoods, and we get a chance to listen to what people have been saying and what their concerns are, what they like about the city, what they want to improve, and it's really, the campaign is going tremendously.
That's great. You know, a couple questions have come up over the course of your campaign that I'd like to address today. One of which is your address. You know, a lot of controversy in regards to you being a Boca Raton resident or
right.
not.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, this gets confusing. I got to tell you, it came down to actually, even back when the controversy over the wildflower property came up, and I had friends of mine that wanted to vote over the wildflower and couldn't,
right.
even though their address says Boca Raton,
right.
and they couldn't vote on the wildflower property, and they were aggravated.
Sure.
Because what do you mean? I live in Boca Raton, and I can't vote on wildflower.
Right.
And yet here you are as a longtime Boca Raton resident, and people are saying, no, he's not a Boca Raton resident. He just moved to Boca Raton. So can you please, once and for all, please let the residents understand what it is and why they're wondering how this came to be, and
sure.
explain to them where all the puzzle and how this fits?
Sure, I'd love to, Peter. I'm smiling in part because I think it's funny that I'm a lifelong Floridian, yet I'm called a carpetbagger by people who aren't even from Florida. I think we talked about this the last time, Peter. My parents met at FAU in 1967. I am a product of Boca Raton. My parents, when I was born, moved to Coral Springs. I guess the house they're in was too small. And I grew up, spent most of my youth in Coral Springs, right down the street. I've lived in South Florida all over. I've lived in Miami for a time, I've lived in Fort Lauderdale for a time, I lived in Aventura for a time. And since 2013, starting in 2013, my wife and I, we bought our first house, and it was in Boca del Mar. And it was in the La Jolla development of Boca del Mar, which is about 1 or 2 tenths of a mile from Boca Raton city limits. I still had a Boca Raton street address. My address said Boca Raton. And I don't think, it's possible that plenty of people in Boca del Mar, and including in La Jolla, thought that they were in fact residents of the city of Boca Raton, when in truth it's just about a tenth or 2 tenths of a mile away. And to put that into perspective, that's about as far as it is from, if you were to walk from Meisner Park Amphitheater down to the southernmost part of Meisner Park, that's about how far away I was from the city limits. And I bought that, my wife and I bought that house back in 2013. As we had our third child, our three-bedroom house was too small, as you might imagine, so we bought a new house, and this one is in Mill Pond, which is in the city limits. So one of my opponents, both of them, but one in particular, has said, well, Andy's new here, he's only been here for 6 months. And that's what makes me chuckle, because I am a lifelong South Floridian. I've resided here in Boca Raton, whether it's a tenth of a mile or not, outside the city limits. I've been here since 2013. And more than that, I've practiced law here since 2011. I've been representing businesses, individuals, in helping them resolve disputes here in our city. And I also, one of my opponents also made a point of saying I've served on no city boards, and that's true, but I've done better. I was appointed recently, well, it wasn't that recently, it was back in 2016, to the Palm Beach County Metropolitan Planning Organization's Advisory Council. And I say that's better because one of the issues that we've been facing in the city recently is traffic. Well, the MPO is the government agency that funds and plans all of the transportation and traffic improvements that we see here in Palm Beach County. And traffic, unfortunately, is not a city issue because, as you know, Peter, a lot of the people who drive into Boca Raton come from Del Rey, Deerfield, Boynton Beach.
Sure.
They come from all over. Traffic is a regional issue. It's not a city issue. So the board that I've been sitting on is one that handles probably the greatest issue that we face in our city right now, and that's transportation. And I've been doing that in order to help Boca Raton meet its traffic needs and improve its traffic situation. So while I haven't served on a city board, I've served on a county board, and one that I think is probably the most important of the boards that we could probably sit on, and that is to help deal with transportation.
Thank you for clearing that up, Andy. Now, another thing I want to bring up, and I know this is something you like to talk about, but I'm going to dig into it a little bit, because it's come up and a lot of people think you're privileged. And I happen to know a little bit about your past, and you don't talk about it, which I think is honorable. But I'd like to talk a little bit about your youth. And most people think that they look at your family and they always think about white picket fences, and they have this image of Andy Thompson, but they don't think about when you were a teenager that you had a different youth and a different teenage years than the average 12 to 16 year old than even my son has. Do you mind telling the residents a little bit about what that was like in your household?
Sure. And you're right, Peter. Frankly, I don't talk about it that much. And you're right to say that I'm blessed right now. I am. I have a terrific, loving, and supporting wife. Hi, Joanna. I know it's Valentine's Day. And we have three beautiful kids, so we are blessed. There's no doubt about that. And I can see why people might think that I have a good life, because I do, frankly. But as privileged as it may appear that I live now, you're right, it wasn't always like that. My parents, when I was young, about 9 or 10, my mom got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. It's a nerve disease that impacts the nerves, and eventually you lose feeling in all parts of your body. You start in your legs typically, it goes to your arms and your hands and works its way up the spinal cord. And when I was a kid, I remember my mom being diagnosed, and an MS diagnosis has a pretty immediate impact on a family. And it's sad to say, but a lot of times when a diagnosis like that comes, it's a shame actually, but you'd be surprised how often the spouse of somebody being diagnosed, knowing how difficult an MS future is, they walk away and they say, I can't handle what's going to come, and they file for divorce. And it's true, an MS diagnosis does impact, you know, your loved one or the person being diagnosed dramatically. But that isn't what happened with my family. Instead, though my mom had immediately she started losing feeling in her legs and she had trouble walking. And as time went on, she had to start using a wheelchair. And as time went on more, she had difficulty using her arms, difficulty eating. And all of this, you know, led, at least at first, she had to stop working. She was a teacher. She was a preschool teacher. And she, which I think takes a whole different level of patience to handle kids of that age, but my mom loves little kids. And that was her career. That was her passion in life, was teaching, you know, really small children. But she had to give that up because she couldn't drive, because she didn't have the strength in her legs to drive anymore. So when she had to give up working, my parents had to move, and we had to give up the house. And it, as time went on, I brought up the fact that a lot of times there's a separation following an MS diagnosis, in part because one of the lessons that I learned from childhood was commitment. It was the commitment that my dad showed to my mom, and because he's been her primary caretaker ever since she was diagnosed 20 some odd years ago. And he did it with a smile on his face, he did it happily, and he did it because he loved my mom. And whatever else may be said about me, I hope no one ever questions my commitment, because I learned it directly from my dad. But because my mom had to give up working, and because she had trouble getting around, the additional, you know, things had to be done around the house that I suppose normally wouldn't have been done by a child, but that, because my dad was busy working, providing for the family, us, and taking care of my mom, those types of things were taken care of by me. And it was the least that I could do to help care for my mom and for my family. So, I mean, yes, I suppose it's true that when I was a kid, it wasn't your average childhood, because we had a different dynamic because of my mom's illness. But I'll tell you this, I learned two things from all that. One was the commitment to those you love, and love requires sacrifice, and that's essentially what my dad did. He gave up a career that he wanted to do. He gave up the hobbies he had just so he could take care of my mom, and that was it. It left a very, very significant impact on me, and I think people who know me now know that if there's somebody committed to things that they love, it's me, because I learned it firsthand from my dad. But I wanted to mention something else too, and that was my mom. Through this entire ordeal, and this is true to this day, she has never complained about her situation. She is basically a quadriplegic now, and never once have I heard her feel sorry for herself or complain about it, though she has every reason to. And what she taught me was there's some things in this world you can't change and you can't control. You can't always control what happens to you, but you can always control your attitude. And so if people think that I have a positive or optimistic view of the world, they're right. They're right, because somehow my mom had a very optimistic view of this world. She still is thankful for the blessing she had, despite having a very, very, very difficult life. If she can somehow remain optimistic, then I think all of us can remain optimistic and look at the good that we have in this world. And I think that translates to our city. There's a lot about our city that people take for granted. There's a lot of good that we have here. There's a lot of special things that make us a unique place to live. And too oftentimes, I think we get caught up in the things that bother us. And I don't mean to make light of stuff like traffic or whether we have enough parks. Those are important issues. I know they are. But I think often, too often, we lose sight of the fact that there are cities around us that wish they had the resources and assets that Boca has. And I sometimes just wish that Boca, we could just remember how good we have it, because I'm not sure that we always do.
I couldn't agree more. One other hot topic. So you've been hammered over the fact that you refused to go on Boca Watch, more so lately because I've come out publicly against Al Zucara for not coming on to Boca Voice after twice agreeing to come on and being interviewed, and twice he's canceled moments before the interview. So unfortunately, they've come out and questioned you again for not agreeing to come on to them.
Yeah.
So publicly, I've answered a couple times, not necessarily with your permission, and I apologize, but can you publicly answer as to why you've disagreed to come on to Boca Watch?
Sure, I would be happy to. Boca Watch is a political action committee that's dedicated to getting its candidates elected. It's no secret that Boca Watch's publisher is running for mayor and that its former editor-in-chief is running for my seat. And so it would be like my law firm asking one of my opponents to come in for an interview to see if they would get my law firm's endorsement for my seat, or if my campaign consultant asked to have my opponents come in and be interviewed to see if they'll get my consultant's endorsement for their race. And it's no secret that the people who, and I know Mr. Zuccaro has said he stepped away from his role at Boca Watch, but there's no secret either that he's left in charge people who have supported him and who have supported one of the other people in my race. Just a few days ago, I saw one of the people who's on Boca Watch now putting up yard signs for Al Zuccaro. And it's no coincidence either that one of the other people that is on Boca Watch now threw an event for one of my opponents. So no, I haven't gone on to Boca Watch, in part because they, given their relationship to the people in this race and their obvious interest in getting those people elected, I don't think any question that they could be possibly fair towards anyone else other than their candidates. And they've taken a very heavy-handed role in trying to get their candidates elected. To me, it's curious that they present themselves as like this news source when they're not. They are a political action committee intended and created, I think, in part, if not solely, to get their people elected, and that's what they're trying to do now. So it wouldn't make sense for somebody like me to go on with, just the same way it wouldn't be make sense for my opponent to be interviewed by my campaign consultant, my campaign manager, to see if they would get the endorsement of my consultant. So, no, I told them no.
Okay. So, I thank you for coming on. As always, I always like to end giving you an opportunity to plug yourself to the residents of Boca Raton. What would you like the residents to know about Andy Thomson and the as you were getting closer to the race?
There's a lot that you can learn about me by visiting my website. It's andyforboca.com. And if you have any questions for me, email me. My email is andy@andyforboca.com or give me a call. My contact information is easy to find on my website. Please, I'd love to chat with you. I'd love to hear what you have to say. I'd love to hear what your concerns are. And one last thing, my team of volunteers, as I mentioned earlier, is growing. If you're interested in volunteering for my campaign, helping me get elected, if you believe in my vision for the city, please give us a call, let us know, help, come help us make phone calls, come help us knock on doors, because we are knocking on doors to a degree and that probably hasn't been seen in this city in a long time. And the movement has, I think, started, and it's still going, and we have one more month until Election Day. And the last thing that I leave everybody with is please, no matter what else you do, please vote on March 14th. Seat B, I'd say please vote for me, Andy Thomson, on March 14th. Thank you.
Andy, thank you for joining us. Thank you for joining us at the Boca Voice, and we look forward to seeing you next week. And we look forward to seeing you this week on Fact or Fiction Friday. Thank you, and don't forget to visit us on Facebook, and we look forward to seeing you next week.